Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode number 81 of the Rewatch Project with Hannah and Mike, where we have reached the fifth episode of season four of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., namely the episode Lockup. Hannah, how the heck are you?
I am well, thank you. I am nearly one week into dry July.
We started. Oh, no, you can't. I am 1 week pregnant. I'm like, wait, you
no,
know already?
I'm not. We started slightly late. We started on the 4th of July.
Oh, I thought you started slightly late, trying for another baby.
What is it with you and baby?
I don't know, you caught me on the back foot with the... You paused at a very dramatic point in that sentence.
There's no babies. I don't want any more babies. You're fully aware
enough
of this fact.
I think we've probably got a couple too many, to be honest with you.
Yes, so we're doing dry July, so it's very... sober in this house.
Although we've got coffee, so you know, we're crazy now. Who knows what might happen?
Coffee at 7:42 p.m.
And also, I have a very, very sore throat, so apologies in advance if I sound even sexier than normal. That will be because of that.
And apologies if he mentions it more than once.
I wouldn't do that, Hannah. I've never seen coffee drank in such a judgmental manner that has been done before. But yes, we are.
It doesn't deal well with being ill.
Well, you know, I don't think anybody enjoys it.
I didn't say enjoys or not enjoys. I said doesn't deal well.
Let's not do this in front of the kids, Hannah. So yes,
they love it.
We have reached the fifth episode of season four of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Hannah, do you want to tell us a little bit about this episode, who wrote it, and all of that good stuff?
Sure. Let's start with the synopsis, which says, as Robbie Reyes struggles to control the Ghost Rider, S.H.I.E.L.D. infiltrates a high-security prison to unravel the secrets that haunt them all.
High-security prison to break out the A-team, perhaps.
Dun, dun, dun. It is directed by Kate Woods.
Yep.
And written by, I'm pretty sure this is the sister team, Nora Zuckerman and Lilla Zuckerman.
Yes, we are assuming that fact, but...
Yes, well, I'm assuming most definitely related.
Yep.
Whether they're sisters, I don't know. Yeah. But, yes.
That sounds quite likely, doesn't it?
Quite likely.
And a quick little bit of housekeeping, just a reminder that we are part of the Pod Syndicate family of podcasts, which includes the Iron Sequel, his film, her movie, Chinstroker versus Punter, the Film Bastards, and Entertainment Landfill. And also, please do check out the Good, the Bad, and the Odd podcast as well. And I also want to mention Talk Without Rhythm podcast as well, because they plug us as well. And that is a really, really good show. So you should check that one out as well. If you want to reach us or speak to us, you can do so through email at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, or you can reach out to us through social media, on Twitter at rewatchproj, that's rewatch proj, and Instagram is the same. And also, if you listen to us on YouTube, then please do feel free to leave comments, like, subscribe, do all of that kind of good stuff.
And we have a couple of YouTube comments, which
cool.
I would love to read.
Yep, well, let's get that feedback. We don't care where we pull it from.
Exactly. These are both on Let Me Stand Next to Your Fire.
Okay.
Right.
Impossible to say, not sing.
Silver Surfer. Hello there again, fellow agents. Completely agree about Coulson chewing out Daisy and Robbie, especially when he's dealt with Tony Stark in Iron Man 2, Thor Odinson in the original Thor film, Tesseract in Avengers, and even helping design Steve Rogers' suit.
Yes.
Peace out.
Yep, he's earned the right to chew out, I would say.
100%.
And always good to hear from you as well.
Yes, absolutely. Right.
It will be a sad day if and when he stops commenting on the podcast.
I will be gutted.
Because that does happen. You do so. Cheers, Drake, for Spencer people who send us feedback every week. At some point, they're gone.
Silver Surfer and Jack Dubs, just hear and know this now. If you stop commenting before the end of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., there will be no closure.
Yeah, or at the very least, you need to recruit somebody to replace you.
No. No.
It wouldn't be the same, would it?
I'll be going to counselling asking if it was me.
Yeah.
Like, what's wrong with
what
me?
What did I do?
Yeah.
No pressure, by the way.
No pressure.
Yeah.
No pressure. Right. Jack Dubs. Greetings, Hannah and Mike. Two episodes in 1 week. We are truly blessed.
Yeah.
I think you two pretty much mirror my own feelings about this episode and your breakdown. The main plot involving Daisy, Simmons, Robbie, Coulson, Mac is very entertaining. The story keeps chugging along, but I think I am a bigger fan of the various comings and goings happening over at Radcliffe's house. Fitz's near mental breakdown at seeing Ada interact with May. Hello, is probably...
yeah.
A lot of the time, Fitz tends to be portrayed as the smartest, most competent person in the room, so it's always a joy to see him on the back foot and have to scramble to keep his composure. Very, very true.
Also, it's a good point as well that the whole Ghost Rider sort of storyline is, because it's, you know, it's a big Marvel character and it's, you know, it's just a sort of sexier storyline, it's easy to forget the other storylines. And I think that in some ways, though, for old school Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fans, that is a compelling storyline because it's the one that is most involving the characters from the show, you know, and those relationships.
Yeah. And it's very, very much the way the writers of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. work, I think, in that you will have your big booming, all flags waving story, and then something subtle just cooking in the background that actually, you know,
ends up being tremendously important. Ends up being
really compelling.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I've got so much respect for the writers. I think it takes pretty talented people to be able to weave the stories they tell the way they tell them.
Yeah, I agree.
And I couldn't do it myself. Shall we get cracking?
Yes. It's also worth pointing out that we had some feedback from one Gabrielle Luna.
I may have squealed.
But
I
shall read it. His feedback.
I'm not in charge of Twitter, so I can't.
He said, listen to the episode. You all had me cracking up. Love me some Kiwi humour. So it's nice to know that Ghost Rider himself has listened. Around. For show, so yes, that was quite a nice, that was a squee moment.
It was,
and
I may have screenshotted it and sent it to my friend who also watches Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, did you?
Look,
what did she say?
She was like, oh my god,
that's amazing. Okay, well, we'll get into this. So, what we're going to do, as we always do, is we're going to hit pause, we're going to watch the episode, and then we're going to come back and we are going to riff, respond, react, review. Episode number 5, namely a Lockup from season 4 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So we will be back with you very, very soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Have you ever wondered what so-called family films will scar your kids forever?
Putting 4 and 5-year-olds in front of this movie, it's like, if they didn't know what death was before this, they're going to know it after it.
They're going to know it after it, and they're going to be freaking terrified.
And they're going to be questioning you.
Yeah.
Or do you have the slight suspicion that your loved one has a cold, dead heart?
Yeah, The Dark Knight has got like all the orphans, and like, oh no, we're going to die. They did not build up those orphans at all. In my head, I was like, kill them.
Then look no further. The His Film Her Movie podcast is the show for you. It's the movie podcast that celebrates the contrasting cinematic tastes of its hosts. So join Jordan and Lauren every week on their unique journey through the land of the silver screen. So if you're looking for a few laughs, some fun film-related chat, then get involved. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Okay, so we've just finished watching the episode Lockup, number five of season 4 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Hannah, initial thoughts?
Another extremely solid episode. Great to see old Jack McPhee from Dawson's Creek briefly.
Who's that? I've never watched Dawson's Creek.
Kerr Smith, the guy who plays Lucy Bauer's husband.
Oh, okay.
The one who comes out.
Oh, yeah, I thought I recognised him from somewhere. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
You got the glasses?
No. Does he have glasses? No.
The one that she brought out of a coma.
Oh, did he have glasses?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, not when he came out of the coma.
Yeah.
But in the flashbacks where they're in the dark.
Oh, in the flashbacks.
Right. I mean, I suppose if he's in a coma, he probably doesn't need them, does he? You don't need anything, really, if you're in a coma.
No.
Just basic sustenance and...
Yeah.
Maybe cloves.
What else did I think of it? I thought there were some amazing one-liners. I loved when May basically gives the guard a withering look when they shoot the antidote into his brainstem, and he sort of winces and she goes, "I'll deal with it."
Yes.
I could relate.
That speaks to you.
It does. Just solid all-round performances, and I love the kind of turmoil that a number of the characters had in this episode.
Yeah.
Like Daisy sort of fighting against wanting to be part of the team and not wanting to put anyone in jeopardy because of her. Also using and not using her powers.
Yeah.
Robbie wanting to help the bigger mission but also bring on Judgment Day for the people in the here and now.
Yeah.
Directly related to his brother's injuries.
And it's difficult to know in that scene how much of that is the ghost and how much is him. You know, because there's indications that there are certain situations where he simply doesn't have control.
Yeah, I think it's pretty 50-50 in that sense.
Yeah, but I would say that in some situations, the ghost probably has to do less work to kind of turn him around on it.
Come out,
you know? Yeah.
I thought Simmons was amazing in this episode, and I love that you kind of get a little turn in confidence with her, because she had that so much in definitely towards the end of the first season going into the second and third, but you sort of feel like her wings have been clipped a bit up until now.
Well, she had a bad time in the last season, didn't she?
She did, but like you know, her wings have been clipped a bit by the new regime, yeah, and that kind of thing. So it's
the Orwellian rules that
it's good to see that the fight hasn't gone out in her.
Like, well, she's still got it, but she just knows that you've got to pick your battles.
Yeah. And also work your way around it.
Yeah.
What did you think?
I really liked it. I like the fact that it's I mean, it's kind of a silly way of referring to it, because I think that these shows, particularly story arc driven shows, you kind of have to view the story as a whole. But I mean, I'd say this is probably my sort of least favourite of the episodes this season so far, but that's a deceptive thing, because this episode had certain things to do. What I did like about this episode, which surprised me, and this reminds me a little bit of what we were talking about earlier on about all the stuff with like Radcliffe in the earlier episodes, about how that seems kind of B-plot, but you realise that actually it's a stealth A-plot.
Yeah.
And this episode's equivalent of that was all the stuff with Mace, which I really liked, because before, in the first couple of episodes, he's played as being kind of doofy, like almost like if David Brent was charismatic, you know?
Yeah.
And the thing I liked about this episode was that you got to see him being really super competent, but also, obviously, you get some shades of grey added to the character, because I think that when the season starts, you're instantly positioned to be suspicious of him, because of all of the, as I say, the slightly...
Well, it's a bit cloak and dagger, isn't it?
Well, you've got all of the sort of fascistic stuff that's going on, and he's just so chipper and gee whiz. I mean, there's a couple of lines of dialogue in this episode that feel like they were straight out the mouth of the mayor in Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that kind of like, gee whiz, golly gosh, but actually evil as fuck kind of vibe.
Yeah.
So I like the fact that you got to see... The actor was obviously cast because he can do that kind of, you know, Kennedy-esque, charismatic but sincere. And I like the fact that genuinely it's difficult to tell. And I think that when the character comes in and he's a new character and he's got the role that we as the audience feel that our lead character should have, and you've got all of this, you know, trust no one kind of imagery around, and he's this sort of homespun American apple pie guy, to actually make you feel like maybe he is a good guy.
Mm.
Is, I think, quite an achievement and shows you how good the actor is. And I was surprised by how much I enjoyed that element of this. And I've said this a lot whilst we've been rewatching S.H.I.E.L.D., that there's loads of times where they go to a storyline and I think, they've gone back to this storyline. But I end up actually really liking that then as well.
Yeah.
It's like there's no filler, in that regard. But and also, I think that as any time you have an episode that's set in a prison, it's always a good opportunity to do some close quarters action. And I think there's some really nicely put together fight sequences and action sequences in this episode as well.
Oh, I think the cafeteria fight scene was pretty amazing.
Mm.
I would 100% be the person that runs straight into a fridge and just gets a door shut on them. that'd be my outcome. I'd suffocate to death while everyone else is kicking ass.
I'll just stay in my cell reading a book like that Fifth Street Hoodlum.
Yeah, but you get flamed if you do that.
Well, and you could get spotted. But should we get into the breakdown?
Yeah.
I feel like we can. Bear with me a moment while I get the old telephonic machine. We open up on a flashback with the word "then" on the screen, so we of course that we're going to get the word "now" at the end of this.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, what we see the scene where the One Tree Hill, Dawson's Creek guy, resplendent in his glasses, pre-coma, and is it Lucy? Is that her name?
Lucy. Yep.
Are looking around a basement for the book, The Darkhold, as we know it, and they find it.
Interesting that she says something about, do you think we should stop this craziness and actually do the science?
Yeah.
And just before they find the book. And the book is kind of like the scientific equivalent of heroin. Like once you do it, you can't stop wanting it.
Yeah.
And you can see that obviously at the end of the episode on the face of Eli Morrow.
Well, they also say about how the way that the book presents itself to them in their own different languages, and she says, it's kind of reading us.
The book's reading them.
And you see him, Bauer, I think is the guy's name, is start to look a little bit kind of power crazed and being affected by it immediately.
Yeah.
So
they stop holding hands.
Yes.
Mm.
Yeah. Immediately you can start to see the vibe changing.
Mm.
And we cut back to now as we see Bauer coming out of his coma and having a bit of an episode. And we see that that Lucy has, in her ghostly form this time, has returned to the basement where they left it and has uncovered it again. But presumably because she's non-corporeal, she's unable to use it, that's her motivation throughout the episode.
Well, because the writing's not there for spirits, I'm assuming.
Absolutely. So we learn that they don't want to tell Mace about the Darkhold. I like the fact that they refer to the pissed off mad scientist ghost. And also, Coulson tells this is a safe space, isn't it? And it's funny because you're seeing sort of terminology of the time come into the conversation. Like, this would have been 2016, 17, something like that.
Somewhere around there, yeah.
And that feels, safe space feels like a very fashionable term from around that sort of era.
Very much so.
So we
2016.
Yeah. We see that Daisy is still keeping her distance. And it's interesting because, May will have the conversation with her later in the episode, but you see May showing an interest in her. And what's apparent, and she says as much at the end of the episode, is that, May knows a thing or two about being emotionally distanced. I like the fact that Fitz is just being a total kiss ass to Simmons because he knows he's in the shit. Like, he's talking about what a great job she's doing and all this kind of stuff. And
which every woman knows just does not have the desired effect.
And we see that she refers to Ada as it.
Yeah.
Not her. And they're talking about the facial tics as well, because as the cliffhanger of the last episode left us, she's obviously now in the know about lots of clandestine stuff that they shouldn't be doing.
Yeah.
And she's got to go in for her, I don't know, weekly facial tics check, which is a bit of a problem. And they talk about how how it works and how difficult it's going to be.
Yeah.
They talk about the penitentiary because what they need to do is go in and get out Robbie's uncle because he was connected to the initial experiments as well. Yeah. May and Coulson go in, and he wants to know what dying was like as well, because he can't remember it. He's had that part of his memory wiped.
Yeah. And it's a complete fascination for him.
Yeah.
He has a natural fascination in it.
Yes. And they go and see the warden, and May is immediately suspicious because there's just lots of weird things happening. And what we learn later, of course, is that they've been ghosted up.
Yeah.
You know, and because they've got the, these neck jabby devices. And I like the fact that, like, Mac is kind of a wuss. Well, not a wuss. I mean, most people wouldn't like having something stuck in the back of their neck. But by S.H.I.E.L.D. standards, you know, he's the kind of, I suppose he's the gentle giant kind of thing, isn't it? You know, that he's the big tough guy, but at the same time, you know, he's the one who sort of says kind of the human thing in a lot of situations.
He still jabs himself in the neck with it, though.
Oh, no, when it comes down to it. Mm. But he's the one who's like, oh, God, this is going to suck, you know, whereas the rest of them are just sort of, you know, business as usual.
I feel like saying to him, you're lucky you're not on Fringe.
Oh, yeah, the shit they have to do to themselves in Fringe. Oh,
Dunham's forever got a bloody spike in the back of the neck.
Yeah, there's lots of spikes in the back of the neck and in the side of the head. And
yeah, and actually, interestingly, the writers of this episode wrote for Fringe as well. So maybe it's
they're just into that shit. Yeah. Quite potentially. So the warden freaks out when he realises that he's been made. May batters him, as she does usually in these situations. It's nice that Coulson gets to use his shield. Because a lot of TV shows have that. They introduce these things, and then the characters don't get to use them that often. Like, I remember in the 80s television series Knight Rider, about two or three seasons in, they introduced some changes to the car, and it could kind of go a bit Power Ranger-y. And one of the things was it would go convertible. There's a button you'd press, and the car would go convertible. And I always remember thinking, that's awesome. And I don't think he ever did it again. And I was always watching Knight Rider at, like, I don't know, the age of 10 or 11, waiting for it to go convertible again.
He doesn't want to mess with this blow wave.
True, I suppose. If I was as hirsute as the Hoff, particularly a 1984 Hoff.
He was a very hairy person.
Yeah, exactly. It's like the... it always cracks me up. Have you ever heard of... I mean, it's horrible to laugh about it. Well, not that I'm laughing about it, but have you ever seen that famous footage of the drunk David Hasselhoff trying to eat that burger?
Off the bathroom floor. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I remember when Noel and Ian and I think Jordan and Mark went to Fright Fest or one of these, and they did a video, and Noel was really drunk on it, and he was eating a supermarket sandwich, and I always remember thinking it had shades of the Hasselhoff trying to eat a burger video about it. And no, it was a good look. But so Lucy and the whole, he calls them Lucy and the whole Peanuts gang, I think he's a nice thing, are there. And Robbie goes with them against Mac's wishes because he's, like, you know, concerned.
Mm.
There's a very nice Quinjet, dare I say, docking shot in this. Indeed. Like there's some nice CGI going on there.
Very nice CGI.
Gemma goes in for her honesty test, and Mace comes to her during it. So, of course, we're all thinking, oh, God, you know, she's busted.
Here
she's
we go. Been
lurking in the shadows. And we go back to Mac talking about his concerns about Robbie and how he just doesn't think that Robbie can control the ghost.
Yeah.
And that's a bit of a loose cannon. But what Daisy's saying is, look, we can't hurt these ghosts. He can. So he's a required asset.
Yeah, absolutely.
In this situation.
And Mac's kind of getting in his own way. They do need him.
Yeah.
Like, aside from the fact that he can harm the ghosts, they're a stronger team with him on it. Yep. It's just that he can't kind of admit that just yet.
And that happens a lot. I mean, there was a lot of that when Sky then joined the group. There was a lot of, I don't know whether she should be coming along on this.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, and Lincoln as well. You know, there's plenty of precedent.
Well, I mean, they never trusted Lincoln.
No.
Not until, like,
the... He died.
Fucking minute.
It's like, yeah, you're all right. We see that a lot of the inmates are watchdogs, so I think the idea is that they're being radicalised whilst they're in prison. We see Lucy, the ghost woman, releases them.
Mm-hmm.
Mace asks Gemma if he can trust her. And that's a bit where he's like, and this is a bit where I felt like he was really like the mayor in Buffy, because he says, can I trust you? She's like, yes. And then his whole countenance changes.
He's like, good,
because boy, I need your help. Mm-hmm. And it's like, wow, that is a lot like the mayor from Buffy.
And it's interesting because you think initially that she's got away with lying.
Yeah.
Like,
no, he just needs her for something.
Yeah, yeah. But like, obviously you find out later that he hasn't forgotten that she's, you know, her results have been flagged up. It's just that she's more important to him by his side at that moment.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. He's being very pragmatic.
Yeah.
But basically he wants her to kind of Cyrano de Bergerac information to him whilst he's on this televised debate. Okay, so we see Robbie grab a chain while they're in the prison, which is becoming his sort of signature weapon, so to speak. I like the fact that when Mac takes out the ghost, he says, ghost busted. And then Juan walks through him and he immediately starts to get that kind of spectro vision thing going on.
Yeah.
But
thankfully he knows what's going on, so
yeah,
he can sort it out.
Gives himself a neck job in order to get rid of that. And we see Robbie stop to... go and see the guy from... hang on, I think I've got ahead of myself here. It's his uncle. Oh, yes, I have, yeah. Oh, yeah, and we see Robbie torch one of the ghosts as well. So he kind of shows Mac his worth, I guess, at least.
Well, he from saves a practical. Mac.
Yeah. We see Senator Nadia again. She's at the debate. This is another instance where we get to see why Mace got the job.
Mm.
Because... he's been given the data by Gemma, but he's not just saying what she's saying. He's translating it into... Yeah.
He's got the gift of the gab.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, he's sort of contextualising it in a palatable way.
Yeah, 100%.
You know, and that's
And he's also adding his own bits and pieces in there. Like, he's... I think that's the thing that this scene does, is remind you that he hasn't got this job out of nowhere. Like, he's an intelligent guy. It's just that...
And he's seen as a hero as well.
We haven't seen those bits of him yet.
Yeah, yeah. Because, I mean, we... And this is a little bit like what we've talked about before, about how a lot of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is about perspective. Because when he comes in, and we're first introduced to him, of course we don't like him because he's not one of our guys.
Well, you don't trust him.
No, but the idea is that he's seemingly... done all of this awesome, cool shit. We've just not seen it, you know, like you say. Yeah. So that kind of means that we have a different perspective on that.
Yeah.
But things start to get a bit tricky for him in the interview when she asks him about the prison. But he basically just pulls the whole, well, you know, we can't talk about any live...
Ongoing missions.
Ongoing missions, exactly. We see as the S.H.I.E.L.D. team are getting chased through the prison that Daisy... in a moment of what May will accuse her of being, you know, suicidal or punishing herself, she locks the rest of the team out of the commissary while she stops to fight the rest of the guys.
Mm.
And there's been a little bit of business about how just the toll it takes on her to use her quake powers.
Yeah.
So it feels like she's having to kind of fight with one hand behind her back. But as she says to Coulson at the beginning, she's like, well, I did all right before then, you know, she was doing all the sort of John Wicky kind of stuff before she had her powers. We see Robbie get his uncle. And I like the phrase as well that the senator says something in the interview, and the term that Mace uses is, that's a dog whistle to hate groups. And that's something that I think has since 2017, when this was on, has... become big part of the news, is the fact that, you know,
100%.
People are like, oh no, I've got a visit to a hate group. Yet what they're saying is obviously a call to arms to, you know, like the Proud Boys or whatever, you know, your sort of hate group du jour is.
Yeah.
he then basically, I think, realizes that now's the time to reveal that he's an inhuman as well. May says that she saw Coulson when she died, so that's kind of a big moment.
May says she saw Coulson.
Yeah, you know, when they're climbing up the tubes and he's been asking her what she saw when she
May
died.
May says, sorry, I thought you said Mace says.
Oh no, May says. Mm. Yeah, I can see how that would that would be problematic. So that's kind of a big moment for them.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It feels like that's maybe a, you know, showing some movement in their relationship.
And you can see why she didn't want to tell him. Because that puts her in a weaker position.
Well, and also, I mean, it's quite a breakthrough for May after, you know, the, not just, you know, her husband and all that kind of stuff, but even before then, like all of the cavalry stuff as well.
Yeah.
It feels like, you know, the May we've seen before would not have admitted that. She's obviously come to a place.
And she's still not comfortable being vulnerable. Yeah. So to get something like that out of her is big.
Well, I think also the fact that she's getting to see what that's like from the outside by what's going on with Daisy. Mm. You know, she's getting to see Daisy being like how she was. And sometimes that's what it's like in life. Sometimes when you see somebody else acting in a way that you've acted, you're like, oh God, yeah, that is kind of fucked actually, isn't it? You know, because you've got just a different perspective on that.
And that's the thing, like, ultimately she sort of knows that it's not going to matter what she says to Daisy. Daisy's going to have to work it out in her own time.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. And so we see Daisy being reckless, and May accuses her of being reckless. We see Robbie go back for the Fifth Street guy. And it's in these scenes where I can see how he got the Terminator role.
Yeah.
There's lots of bits, you know, purposefully striding down the prison, just taking people out. You know, I'm watching it and I'm like, well, that's like, it's like Robert Patrick in Terminator 2, you know? And I would imagine he probably got the role from this, you know?
Has he... what's he done since then?
I'm not sure. Not a huge amount, I don't think. I'm wondering whether maybe he's got like a young family or something and has just taken a couple of years out. Because, I mean, his career was on the up, and I think that he's just... I don't think he's done any films since Terminator. So I think that there's been a little bit of maybe a... taking a couple of years off. And
he's got... Oh, he was in an episode of Love, Death and Robots this year.
Oh, okay. So, he goes back to see the Fifth Street guy, and basically what we learn here is that it was his crew that crippled his brother, but that it was actually a hit. So there's some larger conspiracy going on here.
Yeah.
And that all of the other people in his son who were hit are dead. Mm. Yeah, they ended up dead, burned. And one of the side effects of Robbie going back and torching this guy was that they lost the uncle. The ghost woman got him. I'd love to know, so does she drive? Can she drive as a ghost?
I don't know.
But so we see Simmons turns the micro expressions conversation around on Mace when he, as you say, resumes his sort of investigation into her.
Yeah.
You know, she's like, look, I could see you doing it, and I think that a lot of the mythology around you is questionable.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, okay, well, we don't want that coming out. Like you say, that's a nice scene for her to actually kind of use her smarts. You know, everybody there's good at something. So basically, she knows that he's bullshitting. May goes to see Daisy and accuses her of distancing herself and basically says that she invented that move. And she said it won't work because of Coulson, because he won't let you go. And she's like, well, you know, I don't want that. And May says to her, you don't get to choose who cares about you.
And this is... It just keeps coming back to the same thing every single time. The core of the show is family love. For your family, whether that's your biological family or your created family.
And it's kind of in sickness and in health, you know. It is.
It's, you know, there's... The thing that Daisy is still having to learn is unconditional support.
You're allowed to fuck up.
Yeah, well, that that this person, this father figure, is going to be there come hell or high water. You know, he might be disappointed, but he'll still love you.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. Yeah. And it is definitely a sort of family type terminology. Mm. She says that she'll be gone after this operation. We see that Lucy has the uncle and she wants him to read the Darkhold, as she cannot. And Mace meets with the nasty senator woman, and she says that she's going to basically send this information she's got to ABC News. I notice it's ABC News because it's ABC that make the show, so they're like, well, we may as well plug our fucking news station. And he says, what do you want? Yeah. A bit like Morden from Babylon 5 in that regard. So, yes, Hannah, any final thoughts before we wrap up?
I really enjoyed it. I think last week's was probably slightly more compelling.
Mm-hmm.
But I am so excited for the next episode.
Yeah, it's a good story.
It's going to be a doozy. Yeah, it's just a fucking great storyline,
yeah.
And I'm really enjoying being back in it.
Yeah, it's moving on at a clip.
Yeah.
Quick reminder to everybody that we always appreciate emails at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. Apple Podcast reviews are a biggie, so please go and do those if you could. It takes but a moment. Mm. And you don't have to have iTunes on your phone or download podcasts for iTunes. You can literally just Google, and in fact, the link will be on the show notes, as they always are. But if you just Google Apple Podcasts Rewatch Project, you can just go in and click, and that makes a really big difference. Also, check out our friends' shows. I listed them earlier, so I won't do that again here because I've got a really fucking sore throat. I wanted to mention that a second time because Hannah said a word. And I like to satisfy my wife. Let's just put it that way. Also, check out, if you listen to us on YouTube, I should say, then please like and subscribe. And if you want to comment there, we will also include that on the show. But Hannah, yes, what are we talking about next time?
So next episode is The Good Samaritan. Synopsis says, the shocking origin story of Robbie's transition into Ghost Rider is revealed as the lives of Coulson and the team hang in the balance.
I do like a good origin story.
I love an origin story. It's directed by Billy Gearhart.
Stalwart.
Yeah, Stalwart.
Good old Billy.
And it's written by Jeffrey Bell. I am really, really looking forward to
this. Yeah, that's going
to
be a corker, that one.
It's going to be great.
Okay, cool. Okay, well, that's just this week. It'll be great. Bit of a Friends reference there for the five people who recognise that. But yeah, that's us for this week, guys. We'll see you soon.
Bye.
Bye-bye.